I'm Raj Kumar, President and Editor-in-Chief of Devex, and thrilled to be here today with Dr. Judith Rodin, who is joining us in our Washington, D.C. studio. Of course, known to the Devex audience, aid workers and development professionals around the world know your name and know the work that you do as President of the Rockefeller Foundation. And now we'll know you for this new fantastic book that you've just published, The Resilience Dividend, which we're here to talk about. So thank you for spending a few minutes with us today.
Thanks, Raj. It's great to be here.
Resilience is a term I, of course, have heard a lot about. We at Devex have reported on it a lot, but I felt like I learned a lot in this book, even though it wasn't targeting a development audience necessarily. We've had this long-term challenge between development and humanitarian relief. There's a sense there's a divide there, a line, and people for years have looked at how do we bridge that. And it seems like resilience as a concept has finally done it. Is that the case? You know, what should development professionals, humanitarian professionals think differently now that they are in this resilience world?
Well, I think it is a bridging concept because it's really a skill or a capacity that begins in preparation. So the first phase is readiness and how an entity, an organization, a country, a region, or a community prepares is the first phase. The second phase is really responsiveness. So something bad happens, we can't prevent everything, we can't be ready for everything, but the way we respond really makes a difference. And there are resilience building ways to respond, just as there are resilience building ways to prepare. And then the third phase is revitalization. So in the recovery process, the seeds of revitalization can be sown or they can be destroyed, actually. And so how we think in the recovery about revitalizing and building in the capacity to grow and adapt and even transform in the face of some kind of crisis or disaster is another key concept of resilience. So you can see why it's a bridging concept, as you pointed out.
Right, even in a case like Ebola today, you know, all the aid groups that are working there are starting to use the language of resilience and say we've got to not just address the crisis today, but build the health systems back to a place where we will be better off than we were before this crisis.
So part of the mistake, I think, that we see often in disaster relief and recovery is that there's an immediate rush to build it back the way it was before. And that, after all, is part of what made us vulnerable. So weak pieces shouldn't be rebuilt in the same way. So how we think about building a resilient health system is exactly the same way we should be thinking about building a resilient community or a resilient economic system, and that is the capacity to grow, the capacity to adapt, parts of the system that are self-regulating, that could have safe failure rather than failing catastrophically. You know, how we bend and not break every time there's a blow. One of the major tenets of the book is that actually not every disruption has to become a disaster. And so part of building resilience and that capacity in advance is to prevent every disruption from becoming a disaster or a crisis. We can't prevent everyone, but we may be able to prevent some. So this is to really manage the avoidable, what is avoidable, and then avoid the unmanageable.
And I think to that point, one of the items of the book that I thought was really interesting, of course, the Rockefeller Foundation is known for the Green Revolution, for the work of Norman Borlaug, and you talk about that work, diversifying crops, as actually resilience work, that if it were done today at the Rockefeller Foundation, it would be part of your resilience portfolio.
Absolutely. We obviously didn't use the term in the 50s and 60s when Borlaug and his wonderful team worked, but that is exactly what they were doing. They were building the capacity for countries first in Latin America and then in South Asia to be more resilient with regard to their agricultural productivity, drought and pest resistant wheat and then rice, new kinds of crop varieties that were much more diverse as well. So redundancy and diversity is another key feature of resilience, so that if one thing happens to one piece of the system, the rest doesn't go down. And, you know, we see that all over the world in terms of diminishing excess capacity in the interest of saving money. And redundancy and diversity are a key feature and a key necessity of building a more resilient community or building more resilient health systems.
Yeah, I love that example because I think it connects so much to what development work is. you know, where people, this is not a case of humanitarian relief or of a crisis, this is agricultural development. And yet you're thinking from the very beginning, well, what happens if there's a pestilence that comes in and attacks a certain variety of rice or wheat? Or what happens if there's a drought? We need to be prepared for that. It's a different way of thinking, I think, that connects a lot to how development is done today.
Exactly. And think about it then in all of the places that we do development and in all of the sectors. So how we build housing, it can be resilient or it can be less resilient for the same investment. How we build a road or a bridge, again, for the same investment, there are resilient ways to do it or not.